presented by Dr. Sumandeep Kaur. And Dr. Kaur has already, I think, done her first presentation. I remember that. Am I right? Yes.
Yes, so yes.
Exactly. This is the second one. But before we begin, I have a very sad news to share with our fellows, which is that one of our former fellows, Professor Ramashwar Rai, he passed away on the 10th of August. So I want to talk a little bit about him. Some of you, I'm sure, know him or have known him. Professor Rajveer Sharma definitely also. I suppose Professor N.P. Singh would have known him. And perhaps others. I don't see Professor N.P. Singh here. Otherwise, I would have invited him to say a few words. But I want to reminisce a little bit about Professor Ramashwar Rai. First of all, he was a fellow at IIS from 1998 to 2001. And, he produced a book after his fellowship, as we are all supposed to when we are fellows. This is the book. It is called Political Order, The Vedic Perspective. The Political Order, Vedic Perspective. Now, इस किताब को लेके एक काफी दिलचस्प बात मुझे याद आ रही है, which I'm sure somebody like Professor Raju will appreciate very much, which is Professor Roy के पास जब किताब चली गई तो इतनी उसमें गलतियां थी, he found so many errors that he immediately ordered that all copies should be withdrawn and destroyed. तो इस किस्म के वो आदमी थे, तो ये किताब आपको नहीं मिलेगी. एक्चुअली बहुत बढ़िया किताब है, मैंने देखी है. इसकी प्रतियां बहुत दुर्लभ है क्योंकि सारी किताबें वापस उन्होंने मंगवा ली. अच्छा, मेरा उनसे सबसे पहले परिचय कैसे हुआ, वो इस किताब के द्वारा. ये आपको दिख रही है, गांधी, इसका नाम है गांधी एज ए ग्लोबल क्राइसिस, एंड द प्रेजेंट ग्लोबल क्राइसिस. तो ये 1993 की किताब है, इफ आई एम नॉट मिस्टेकन, नहीं 1996 की है, सॉरी, ये 1996 की किताब है. एंड जहां तक मुझे याद आ रहा है, मैंने इस किताब का एक रिव्यू भी लिखा है समर हिल में, तो आप लोग जाके देख सकते हैं. क्योंकि इस किताब में जो मॉडर्निटी है, आधुनिकता है, उसका क्रिटिक है फ्रॉम अ गांधीयन पर्सपेक्टिव. तो मुझे ये किताब काफ़ी अच्छी लगी. बट उसके पहले प्रोफेसर रॉय और मेरी एक थोड़ी सी झड़प हो गई थी, तो मैं वो आज मेरे मन में आ रहा है. ऐसे हुआ कि मैंने किताब लिखी थी, उसका शीर्षक था डी कॉलोनाइजेशन एंड डेवलपमेंट, हिंद स्वराज रिविजन. तो वो 1993 में किताब छपी और उसमें एक संवाद है, जैसे गांधी जी के हिंद स्वराज 1909 में भी एक संवाद है बिटवीन एन एडिटर एंड अ रीडर. मेरी किताब में भी एक संवाद था बिटवीन अ टीचर एंड अ स्टूडेंट. एंड वो किताब ये सोचने की कोशिश कर रही थी कि आज के संदर्भ में गांधी जी के विचार जो थे स्वराज के बारे में, आधुनिकता के बारे में, इकोलॉजी, जो सुमनदीप जी इससे बहुत मतलब उनका वाकिफ है, इकोलॉजी, डीप इकोलॉजी एट्सेट्रा. तो गांधी जी के जो विचार थे इन विषयों पे, आज आजकल के दौर में क्या वो प्रासंगिक हैं. और वो 1993 में मैंने किताब लिखी थी और वो इस तरह निकली कि उस समय चीफ मिनिस्टर आंध्र प्रदेश के, मैं यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ हैदराबाद में पढ़ाता था, चीफ मिनिस्टर चन्ना रेड्डी जी थे और उनको हटाया गया. कैसे कि बहुत बड़ा उधर एक सांप्रदायिक दंगा हुआ हैदराबाद शहर में, पूरा शहर कुछ दिनों के लिए बंद हो गया था. हम लोग जैसे अभी कोविड के समय कर्फ्यू में हैं, एक किस्म से लॉकडाउन कहते हैं हम, तो उस समय भी पूरा कर्फ्यू लगा था. तो उस दौरान मैंने वो किताब लिखी 10-12-15 दिन में, जैसे गांधी जी ने भी वो हिंद स्वराज किताब एकदम लेफ्ट हैंड राइट हैंड दोनों से लिखी थी 19 दिन में, शिप पर, एक SS किल्डोनल कासल नाम की बहुत बड़ी नौका थी जो साउथहैम्पटन से साउथ अफ्रीका जा रही थी, उसमें उन्होंने वो किताब लिखी थी. मैंने भी कुछ उसी तरह से किताब लिखी. और ये जो डेवलपमेंट है, हेलो, विकास, विकास की बात होती है, तो क्या विकास विकास है या विकास बर्बादी है? ये भी मैंने थोड़ा सा इसके बारे में सोचा था, गांधी जी को लेकर के। तो सेज ने किताब छापी, उसमें एक अच्छा, बहुत अच्छा, बहुत ही मैं तो कहता हूँ बहुत ही एक सुंदर प्रेफेस तो नहीं कहेंगे उसको, लेकिन एक प्रस्तावना टाइप लिखी थी आशीष नंदी जी ने। तो उसको उन्होंने ट्रायलॉग कहा था। ट्रायलॉग क्या है? नॉर्मली संवाद होता है, गांधी जी और रीडर राइटर का संवाद था वहाँ, सॉरी एडिटर रीडर का संवाद था, मेरा टीचर स्टूडेंट का संवाद था। तो उन्होंने एक ट्रायलॉग किया। तो ट्रायलॉग में कौन था? गांधी जी थे, उनके बेटे हरिलाल थे, जो बहुत ही उनकी ट्रबल्ड रिलेशनशिप थी, बहुत ही ट्रबल्ड थी, यहाँ तक कि हरिलाल जी एक्चुअली उन्होंने इस्लाम कबूल कर लिया था, एज यू नो, एंड इन अ वे टू स्पाइट हिज फादर, एंड इट वॉज अ वेरी ट्रबल। उसके बारे में कुछ क्या कहते हैं, कुछ प्लेज भी लिखे गए, और वो हमेशा कहते थे कि गांधी जी ने उनको वैसा प्रेम नहीं दिया जो एक पिता ने अपने पुत्र को देना चाहिए था। और गांधी जी कहते थे, मेरा कोई पुत्र नहीं है, सब मेरे संतान है। इस तरह से वो एक उनमें एक संवाद था। और फिर आशीष नंदी ने कहा, मैं ग्रैंडसन हूँ। तो गांधी जी है, हरिलाल है और आशीष नंदी है, ऐसे एक ट्रायलॉग उन्होंने बनाया, ये प्रस्तावना लिखी। तो उस दिन हमारे रामाश्रय रॉय जी थे, वो CSDS में थे, एक्चुअली ही वॉज वन ऑफ द फाउंडिंग मेंबर्स ऑफ द सेंटर फॉर द स्टडी ऑफ डेवलपिंग सोसाइटीज, एंड इन माई व्यू ही वॉज क्वाइट एन ओरिजिनल थिंकर। सो इन एक 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 पत्रिका निकलती थी उस जमाने में, शायद अभी भी निकलती है, जिसका नाम है द बुक रिव्यू। द बुक रिव्यू, इट यूज टू बी एडिटेड बाय चंद्राचारी एंड वन मोर लेडी देस टू एडिट इट। तो ही रोट अ स्केथिंग रिव्यू ऑफ माई बुक, फ्रेंकली, विच हर्ट मी डीपली, यू नो। उन्होंने, मे बी इट्स ट्रू ऑल्सो, वॉट एवर ही रोट, मैं वो नहीं कहता हूँ, बिकॉज वी गेट अटैच टू आवर वर्क। सो ही सेड, इनको तो कुछ समझ ही नहीं है, गांधी जी की तो समझ नहीं है, इंडिया की भी समझ नहीं है, ऐसे वैसे उन्होंने लिख दिया। तो मुझे कुछ बुरा लगा, और जब मैं थोड़ा सा क्या कहें, मातम मना रहा था, जैसे कोई आपकी किताब की धजिया उड़ाता है तो ऑब्वियसली आपको बुरा लगता है, तो मैं थोड़ा सा मायूस हुआ था। तब मैं रमण महर्षि पढ़ रहा था उन दिनों, आज भी पढ़ता हूँ कभी कभी। तो एकदम एक उनका एक कोटेशन मुझे याद आ गया। तो उन्होंने ये लिखा है कि आपके बारे में जब कोई बहुत बुरी चीज़ कहता है, आपको बुरा लगता है, ठेस लगती है, तो आपको ठेस नहीं लगती, आपके ईगो को ठेस लगती है, ये उन्होंने लिखा है। एंड देन ही रोट, द एनिमी हेट्स द ईगो विच द सीकर वॉन्ट्स टू किल, दस लाइक द एनविल टू द गोल्ड स्मिथ ही इज एक्चुअली अ फ्रेंड। तो ये बहुत मुझे एकदम लिबरेटिंग सा मुझे लगा कि रामाश्रय राय ने एक बहुत मेरे लिए अच्छा काम किया कि मेरे ईगो को फ्लैटन करके मुझे थोड़ा सा उन्होंने मार्गदर्शन किया। तो ही इज माई ट्रू फ्रेंड बिकॉज ही इज द एनिमी ऑफ माई एनिमी, माई एनिमी इज द ईगो, ही इज द एनिमी ऑफ माई एनिमी, सो इज अ ट्रू फ्रेंड। और एक कन्नड़ा यहाँ कोई नहीं जानता, लेकिन एक पुरंदर दास की एक रचना है कि निंदे करीर बेकू, यानी निंदक होने चाहिए, निंदक क्या करते हैं, आत्मा की शुद्धि करते हैं, ये उनका एक था। तो कुछ दिनों बाद मुझे रामाश्रय राय जी मिले, एक हम सेमिनार में थे, तो कुछ मैंने चीज़ें कही उसमें, उनको अच्छी लगी होगी, मेरे पास आए और मैंने, और उन्होंने कहा कि आप कौन है, लगता है कुछ आप थोड़े सेंसिबल किस्म के आदमी लग रहे हैं मुझे। मैंने कहा, सर आपने मेरे किताब की धज्जियाँ उड़ाई है, मैं ही वो बदनसीब लेखक हूँ, डिकॉलोनाइजेशन एंड डेवलपमेंट, हिंद स्वराज रिविजिटेड, एकदम उन्होंने मुझे ऐसे नहीं, फिर मैंने तो मेरे तरफ ऐसे देखते थे, देख रहे हैं, तो तक रहे थे 2 मिनट के लिए। फिर मैंने उनको रमण महर्षि कोट किया, मैंने कहा, सर लेकिन यू आर द एनिमी ऑफ माई ईगो नॉट माई सेल्फ, सो यू आर माई ट्रू फ्रेंड। एज सून एज आई सेड इट, ही हग्ड मी, यू नो, एंड इट वॉज सो ब्यूटिफुल दैट मोमेंट, कि मैं कुछ बता नहीं सकता। सो ही वॉज अ ग्रेट मैन, ही वॉज अ ग्रेट स्कॉलर, ही वॉज अ मैवरिक, कुछ उन्होंने 16-17 किताबें लिखी हैं, ही डिडंट फिट इन टू, थोड़ा सा सोशलिस्ट टाइप लीनिंग थे उनके, बट ही डिडंट फिट इन टू एनी मोल्ड, ही वॉज नॉट अफ्रेड ऑफ एनी बॉडी, एंड एक एक जैसे जो इंटेलेक्चुअल होना चाहिए कि एक मतलब इंटेलेक्चुअल अलग किस्म के होते हैं, मैं ज़्यादा नहीं बोलूँगा। एक तो स्टेटिस्ट इंटेलेक्चुअल होता है ना, कि जो पार्टी है कोई स्टेट है उससे अलाइंड होता है। दूसरा होता है एनजीओ इंटेलेक्चुअल, हमेशा किसी एनजीओ से अलाइन हो जाता है वो, ठीक है। तीसरा इंटेलेक्चुअल होता है जो एम्बसी, यूसेफी, यूएसआईएस, मैक्स मूलर भवन, किसी फॉरेन संगठन से अलाइंड इंटेलेक्चुअल होते हैं। और एक बहुत कम ग्रुप होता है जो मैं उनको हमेशा कहता हूँ स्वराजिस्ट इंटेलेक्चुअल्स, है ना, स्वराज इन आइडियाज की तरफ जाते हैं। अपना अपना स्वराज्य है, वैचारिक स्वराज्य है, उसके लिए वो जद्दोजहद करते हैं। वो रामाश्वर राय उस किस्म के इंटेलेक्चुअल थे, बुद्धिजीवी थे और एक मस्त किस्म के आदमी थे। तो आज हम उनकी याद में हम 1 मिनट का शोक मनाएंगे, और लेकिन मैं इनवाइट करूंगा कोई उनको जानता हो, जैसे हमारा रीत रिवाज है इंस्टीट्यूट का, तो उसी उसी तरह से हम भी, हम में से कोई भी उनके बारे में कुछ कहना चाहे तो मैं आपको आमंत्रित करता हूँ। राजवीर जी, आप कुछ कहेंगे तो मैं आभारी हूँगा आपका सर। हाँ जी, कहिए।
सर योर माइक इज ऑफ।
करना होगा।
आपने खुद ही प्रोफेसर रामाश्वर राय के बारे में संक्षेप में कहते हुए भी बहुत कुछ कह दिया। मेरा उनसे परिचय कोई निजी किस्म का तो नहीं रहा, लेकिन मैं दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी में जब पढ़ाता था या पढ़ता था तो जो CSDS है वो नॉर्थ कैंपस के बहुत नज़दीक था, तो उस समय भी प्रोफेसर रामाश्वर रॉय का नाम एक लेखक के तौर पर, एक विचारक के तौर पर, एक थिंकर के तौर पर, एक लिबरल के तौर पर, एक अनएलाइड इंटेलेक्चुअल के तौर पर था। और मैं उनसे सिर्फ उनका नाम सुनकर के एक बार चला गया कि डॉक्टर साहब मुझे आपसे बात करनी है। हु आर यू? फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन, हु आर यू? सर आई एम ए स्टूडेंट एज वेल एज ए टीचर इन दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी। आई टीच पोलिटिकल साइंस एंड आई हैव कम टू सीक योर गाइडेंस इन माई रिसर्च वर्क। ओ, हाउ डू यू नो आई कैन गाइड यू? तो दैट इज हाउ आवर एक्वेंटेंस विद प्रोफेसर रॉय बिगेन। एंड आई डोंट रिमेम्बर ए डे when he did not grant me audience, even if I went without it. That was the kind of a intellectual which he carried, and a human being who never thought that he has come to me without any appointment. How do you come and without you encroach upon my time? He never said like that, and gave an hour or so on whatever I wanted to discuss with him. So therefore, I remember with great reverence. And in fact, every teaching community, the academic world, suffered a great loss in him. And it is not merely his family; it is India which has lost quite a deal in Professor Ramaswamy Roy. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Anybody else would like to say something who knew him personally? Well, I can only say that he lived to a ripe age. He was 87, I believe, and I can only say that he will be missed, and he was our fellow, and therefore we cherish his work and his memories. And let us please observe some few moments of silence now. Thank you. थैंक यू ऑल वेरी मच. मैंने काफ़ी वक्त आप लोगों का ले लिया है. आई विल नाउ रिक्वेस्ट प्रसेंजी जी टू प्लीज कंडक्ट द प्रोसीडिंग्स. इट लुक्स लाइक अ वेरी नाइस रेसिप्रोकल रिलेशनशिप. सो आई थिंक आपने उनका चेयर किया, अब आपका वो चेयर करने हैं. प्लीज प्रसेंजी जी, प्लीज कैरी ऑन. ऑल द बेस्ट सुमनदीप जी, आई विल बी लिसनिंग टू यू. गो अहेड.
थैंक यू सर. थैंक यू.
So, thank you, sir. Yeah, I hope I'm audible. Am I audible? Yeah. Thank you everyone for being here and for this very important presentation. It was very important work of Dr. Sumandeep Kaur. For me, her work is especially important because she addresses ecology and the way ecology is generally studied in social sciences. I mean, we study ecology through specific theoretical frameworks, and we social sciences is always bound by by certain vocabulary and by certain frameworks, and we always tend to study ecology through those frameworks. A work which specifically looks at the way ecology is looked at in novels, and the way in novels as a form of knowledge, the way they look at ecology, it's extremely important because novels don't have to adhere to any any framework, any theory, any vocabulary. You have the author's imagination, and you just the author can run away with it. But at the same time, it's a novel as a it's extremely important to bring the truth out, because and this truth is generally not bound by any framework as such, and that is why Sumandeep's work is so important, especially with regards to ecology, to look at how authors of some very beautiful Punjabi novels, the way they look at ecology. So without any more, without taking more time, I would hand it over to Dr. Sumandeep. And please.
Thank you, everyone. So this is my second presentation, technically the first presentation. And so I have divided my presentation into two parts. And in the first part of my presentation, I shall talk about the theoretical framework I have outlined for my project. And so along with that, I will also outline the limitations of this framework, marking out the cultural specificities of the region, because all the novels are based in Punjab. This part will also include the historical, social, and cultural context against which I have situated the eco-critical reading of my works. So since I already introduced all the novelists which I have taken up for my project in my introductory presentation, so I shall not be talking about them in this. So and in the second part of my presentation, I shall focus on the writings of Jasbir Mann. And I have selected two of his novels. He has written 5 novels so far, and his other 3 novels are also somehow broadly related to the issue of ecology and the agrarian crisis in Punjab. But that is not the main focus of the novels. They are mainly related to the problem of 84 and the different dimensions of that. So I have excluded those novels, and I have included 2 novels. One of them is Akhri Pindi Katha, the story of the last village, which was published in 1993. And the second is Akhri Babe, the last elders, which was published in 2019. So he started writing when the social and political fabric of Punjab was changing entirely. The intervention of state and market mechanism in the traditional agricultural setup, disillusionment caused by the failure of the Green Revolution, then rise of communal conflict, then breakdown of social and cultural structures, etc. So this transformation had a significant influence on the collective psyche of people. It was the psyche deeply rooted in the oral tradition and folk wisdom that now began to undergo stress and strain. So in that sense, Mann actually closely observed what was happening around, and it became the part of his writings. And then the ecological concern also becomes a part of his writing in this broader context. So I now move to the first part of my presentation, that is the theoretical framework which I have taken up and the other aspects related to it. With the joint publication of Cheryl Glotfelty and Harold Fromm, the Eco-Criticism Reader, Landmarks in Literary Ecology in 1996, and Lawrence Buell's The Environmental Imaginations, critics worked for bringing about a unification of man and nature with one foot in literature and other on the land. However, when eco-criticism developed in the early decades of 1990s, it focused mostly on British and American literature, especially the Romantic poetry, the American nature writing tradition from Thoreau onwards. Since 2000, it has expanded its reach and scope and opened up African, Caribbean, and South Asian literatures, in particular to environmental approaches. The eco-critical perspective is marked by its interest in how the non-human interacts with human culture, how ecological conditions shape cultural expression, and how cultures also shape the perception and uses of nature, how cultural communities structure and give meaning to humans' relationship with other species, how crises amplify or reduce socio-cultural differences and also change the cultural practices. So this distinction between nature and culture was also questioned, and socio-centric perspective was favored. In this eco-critical perspective concurs with other branches also, like ethics, history, religious studies, anthropology, sociology, etc. The primary concern of the eco-critics is to read creative works with an ecological conscience, and many critics believe that art with an ecological imagination may shape the actions of a reading public. As Lawrence Buell argues that literary texts function as acts of environmental imagination that may affect one's caring for the physical world. However, Jonathan Bate points out that the business of literature is to work upon consciousness, the practical consequences of that work, social, environmental, political in the broadest sense, cannot be controlled or predicted. Keeping in view the significance of non-human and ecological thought and the recurring risks that many communities around the globe confront, water scarcity, soil erosion, pervasive toxification, the loss of biodiversity, climate change, etc., we might surmise that the eco-critics would highlight a global culture and a literature of ecological significance that may take precedence over local specificity. I want to point out that there is a risk of subordinating the cultural differences to shared themes. Given this context, we have to be aware of the dangers of imposing theories developed in different contexts. I will quote here Laura Barbus Rodden, who says that theories and reading methodologies must be adapted, transformed, and sometimes discarded altogether when taken from their original context and applied somewhere. Why I have taken up the issue of this context, because I look at how eco-critical reading has been pursued in Punjabi literature. So there are some of the writings which I found, I found one of the writings in which there was a comparative analysis of the poetry of Pai Veer Singh and Wordsworth. Now, the context of these two writers is totally different, and we can read them from eco-critical perspective, there is no problem. But it should not happen at the cost of neglecting what is the context of these writers. Wordsworth is writing in 19th century. It can happen mechanically at the level of saying that how nature has been represented in these texts. But when it comes to that, you have to focus on what are the other cultural contexts in which the ecological imagination has been pursued by the writer, then it becomes problematic. Wordsworth was writing in 19th century in the context was different, and when Pai Veer Singh was writing, though nature was important part of his writings, but the major thrust of his writing was associated with the Sikh Lahar movement and other Sikh movements in the beginning of the 20th century. Similarly, there is another work where there was this eco-critical perspective applied to Guru Nanak Bani. So that also I found that, no doubt when you read Guru Nanak's Bani and you find that, there are these lines, Pavan Guru Pani Pita Mata Tart Mahat, saying these things does not mean that you can mechanically take a different contextual theory and apply it on the writings of Guru Nanak. So when we look at other writings in Punjabi, like Bhule Shah, Waris Shah, and writings of Puran Singh, so we can see these writings from the perspective of how nature has been represented, and we find a certain, you know, oneness with the cosmos or nature, which actually finds a shift when you come to when we, you know, see the writings after 1947. So in that sense, I have that is why I have tried to look at the contextual importance of the eco-critical reading of these writings. But I also want to point out here that the possibility of contact and cross-fertilization should also not be closed. So I agree with Karen Thornburn, a scholar of East Asian literatures who writes in Eco-Ambiguity. Literary systems should be studied not along cultural national lines only, but also in terms of intercultural thematic and conceptual networks. In this sense, eco-criticism has also sought to investigate how particular templates of storytelling and image-making shape humans' real-life interactions with the natural world in ways that are historically and culturally distinctive. This is the reason that along with the literary theorist, I have also drawn on the works of Vandana Shiva, Amitav Ghosh, T.G. Jacob, and Ranjana Padhi. So, now I move to the context of the these writings, or how I understand them, the eco-critical reading of these writings. I mean, it's like particularly in that context in Punjab, when there were no environmental organizations working like ASLE and ISLE, and there was no environmental movements like CIPCO and all. So how do we understand then? So in that sense, the context becomes very, very important. The province of Punjab has always been heterogeneous in social as well as natural terms. If we look at undivided Punjab, the central alluvial plains, densely populated and dominated by settled cultivation, the arid southeast, the tract in the northwest known as the Bar, where nomads predominated, the desert region between the Jhelum and the Indus, the hills around Rawalpindi were the characteristic features of its diversity. After the colonial intervention, some very interesting developments happened. The key aspect of the colonial ideology was to develop settled agriculture as the norm within the rural and denied other forms of rural livelihood. The pastoralists, forest dwellers, and food gatherers were settled, and their access to the natural resources was curtailed. Instead of developing industry here, the British made it a hub of agrarian material. Commercial crops like cotton were produced in order to fulfill the needs of textile mills in England. Punjab was developed as an agrarian sector. Canal colonies were set up, and irrigation channels were dug to promote intensive agriculture. And 4 million acres previously under the control of pastoralists were carved up for agrarian settlement. Niladri Bhattacharya points out that it was during this time of settled cultivation that individual villages were demarcated into standard units. This expansion in the agrarian economy went till 1930s, and Punjab worked as a colony which was exploited to expand capitalism somewhere else. So this grand project had its own ecological costs, which are not focused here. I mean, however, it is very important, and I have seen it in another context. However, the situation changed after partition. The agrarian and industrial economy of Punjab was severely dislocated by partition. The rich canal colony is going to Pakistan, and millions of rural and urban people forced to migrate under distressed conditions. The peasantry was the worst affected because of immobility of land. There is another side to this story. Failure of the agriculture sector to meet the demands of India after 1947 until 1965 reflected in the growth of the industrial sector. The lack of proper technological change and the land reforms combined with the droughts brought India to the verge of massive famine in the mid-1960s. However, this situation was averted by massive shipments of subsidized food grains, mainly wheat, by the USA. Mechanization of agriculture, excess of fertilizers and pesticides, high yielding varieties of seeds, etc. Irrigation canals and hydropower projects formed an important part of this. And these developments first started in Punjab. It raised the productivity of the land, but also brought significant changes in the rural structure and local and regional politics. Bhagwan Josh argues that the intervention of the capitalist model gained ground through the exploitation of peasantry, and the terms of trade were tilted towards urbanization and industry. Any significant upward thrust in the development of industry and industrial needs an agrarian hinterland to feed the rising number of urban people and supply raw material to the industries. The potential growth of agriculture as a lucrative market for the output of big industries is of supreme importance. Thus, it was an integrated development pattern, and the Green Revolution came up as an important part of it. Initially, there was a euphoric mood about the development brought in by the Green Revolution. However, this euphoria and eulogization of development models started giving way to social, economic, ethnic, cultural, and ecological problems that led to disillusionment and frustration. So it is against this background that I have situated the eco-critical readings of these novels. And Vandana Shiva here points out that ecological and ethnic fragmentation and breakdown are intimately connected and are an intrinsic part of a policy of planned destruction of diversity in nature and culture to create the uniformity demanded by centralized management systems. So I want to point out here that it's very significant that the writings which I have taken up are mainly associated with the period post Green Revolution, but there is a broader neglect on the part of Punjabi writers taking up what was the development in the colonial period. So that does not become the part of the fictional universe of these writers. So that creates many problems, and that actually, you know, hampers their overall understanding of how they have to see the history of Punjab, and then how do they understand these developments in terms of writing their fictional role. So now in this, I will move to the second part of my presentation, which is based on the novels of Jasbir Mann, and I have titled it as Disjointed Landscapes, Reading Mann's Novels, because I have analyzed these novels from this perspective of understanding what was the landscape, the internal landscape and the outer landscape. So I have selected these texts with a dual purpose in mind: to offer a literary analysis of expressions of eco-critical imaginations in Punjab. These fictional texts present a trajectory to understand the ecological changes and warn of an apocalyptic future, not in that sense that everything will end, but something which is becoming very, very problematic for Punjab in the years to come. So these texts have been written between a period of 2.5 decades and deal with distinct ideas. They also become a literary and cultural document to trace the developments happening after the second half of the 20th century. Thus, ecological imagination in these works does not mean a shallow portrayal of nature, but these also become a significant medium to present a critique of contemporary social, economic, and political realities. These also mark a sign of sickness of the present, to borrow a phrase from Jonathan Bate. Now, here I also want to focus on the lack of development of novel in Punjabi, which T.G. Jacob has also pointed out in his writings. I mean, it's like the first novel in Punjabi was written in 1896 or 7. And the history of novel in Punjabi is more than 100 years old. Still, there is, we do not find that kind of maturity in Punjabi novel as compared to other genres. I mean, it's like when I have selected these novels for my project, there is a reason behind it. I mean, it's like the poetry in poetry, stories and essays also have also dealt with this issue, but that is in a very, very fragmentary form. So we do not get a kind of a holistic picture of that how these writers, the story writers and poets, are dealing with these issues. And moreover, the kind of developments which were happening in Punjab, and particularly in 80s and 90s, so the major focus of the writers was on pointing out what was the political development in Punjab at that time. So there was their focus. I mean, it was in 1986 that there was a committee formed that first pointed out what would be the ecological repercussions of Green Revolution. Still, it did not become part of the writings which were being written at that time. I mean, I'm talking about other genres, not novel here. And still, I mean, even if I have to talk about the novel also, the first novel which was written by Mann only, that was in 1986, where he dealt with this idea that how the development model created by the capitalist intensive agriculture gave way to this, you know, ecological problems in Punjab. So there is lack of development of novel in the modern sense of the term. That is a serious reflection of the stunted growth of Punjabi culture. We cannot say the same about poetry and drama. A very rich tradition of folklore exists in Punjabi, but however much poetry and theater and other genres may be developed, they have a limitation. Namely, they do not possess to the same degree as the novel the capacity to analyze the society in its holistic and complex forms. So, I mean, when I talk about the novels of Nadeem, novels of Jasbir Mann, so before that, you know, there is there are two other significant writings which dealt with this issue of ecology and the broader agrarian crisis which was part of Punjab at that time. One was Gurdayal Singh's Madi da Diva, and then other was Baljeet Kaur's Para Hitli Tarti. But when we move to Mand's writing, so I would say that it is even a next step from that, like because in those writings, the main focus was the changing relationship between the farming community and there was conflict between the old and the new generation in terms of what were the broader social, political, economic changes happening in Punjab. So that is why, you know, I say that, you know, Mann's writing is the next step of that. So he translates his own experience of peasantry into his novel. There is a dialogue of three generations representing different time periods. It is a tale of camaraderie between peasantry and nature. The novel presents the tradition through Birsa. Who represents the tradition of peasantry in Punjab. And the second, then there is this time of Green Revolution being represented by his son, and the present, or that is represented by his grandson. So the novel does not only present a dialogue among these generations, but also presents their viewpoint. They live in the same house, still represent different time periods. The novel unfolds through Birsa, who is looking at the present through the prism of the past, constituted by his rich experience of peasantry and organic relationship with nature. Alienated from his land and environment and his present, he takes refuge in the past, represented by his own parents. They represent that part of tradition of Punjab which has become totally non-existent. The novel is an attempt to make that tradition alive and relive it. Consequently, there appears a conflict between three generations as they represent entirely different worldviews. So there is a lot in the, you know, when we analyze these novels based in the agrarian structure of Punjab that escapes the eye of economists, sociologists and journalists, which comes in the novel. And writing about the novel, P. Lal says that so far we have known only the external aspects of agrarian life in Punjab. However, the novel takes us deeper. The way he portrays the deep relationship between farming and nature is unprecedented in Punjabi novel. It was because of this deep connection that the farming community nurtured and prospered. I have analyzed Mann's novels in terms of two landscapes, one outside the self and other within. The external landscape is the one we see, not only the line and color of the land and its shading at different times of the day, but also its plants and animals in season, its weather, its geology, the record of its climate and evolution. One learns a landscape fully, not by knowing the name or identity of everything in it, but by perceiving the relationship in it. The second landscape is an interior one, a kind of projection within a person of a part of the exterior landscape. The speculations, intuitions, and formal ideas we refer to as mind are a set of relationships in the interior landscape with purpose and order. The interior landscape responds to the character and subtlety of an exterior landscape, and the shape of the individual is affected by land and environment. So, in this sense, the novel depicts how human is connected to the physical world, affecting it and being affected by it. There is an interconnection between nature and culture, human and non-human. In the words of Barry Commoner, everything is connected to everything else. Coming back to the novel, standing deep within his fields, Birsa perceived and understood everything as it was. The ants, pigeons flying over his head, insects coming out of the soil, clouds hanging around him, whereas his grandson is not even aware of the presence of these creatures around him. Even Birsa's thought process cannot be segregated from the land. The specific features of the landscape help him to remember those stories coming down from his parents that helped him make sense of the world and helped his generation to live in the land. This close relationship with the land also demonstrates an interior journey of awareness and imagination in which he grasps his cultural identity. The fields for him have living existence. Nothing is overlooked and taken for granted by him. Each cloud, each ant, each insect is imbued with great value simply because the creature is alive in a place where any life at all is precious. He even recognizes the ant that had been seen a day before, burnt by the heat of the burning of the haystack. Here I want to point out that Mann presents a very different perspective of looking at this, the prevalent culture in Punjab and neighboring states also, that whenever there is this paddy season, every year we see this problem of burning of the haystack and then rising pollution and all. He does not only point out, what are the external aspects of it, that it leads to pollution and all. Through this small, describing this small incident, he actually reclaims the relationship of the farmer with his land. Because when Birsa is standing in his fields, he is not looking at that what kind of tendency has developed there in Punjab that, after you have got crop from your fields, there is not this sense of respecting the fields but burning it so that you can prepare it for the coming season. So in this, when I'm talking about this burning of the haystack and the relationship of the farmer with the his fields and his close association with nature, I lost the track of it. He recognizes that ant that had a day before burnt by the heat of the burning of the haystack. So it's not only that he is focusing on this prevalent idea which is there in Punjab that leading to pollution and all these things, but the writer here also focuses on the intensity of the intensive agriculture which took shape after the Green Revolution, because it gave way to that there is no space left for the fields. It's like you're producing two or more crops in a single year. So earlier there was this tradition that the fields were left free, that is fallow fields, and through this tendency of fallow fields, the writer has also commented on what kind of nature humans have developed. That is, if there is this tendency of intensive agriculture where there is no space for the fields to regain their fertility again, so he says that humans have also got that kind of tendency that they do not have any kind of space for themselves where they can think, they can sit freely and rethink what kind of actions they are taking. So in that kind of busyness and not keeping themselves fallow for a certain season is also having repercussions for the broader, you know, not only I would say that the ecology here, but it is also very important from the point of view of when we see the social, economic and political context of Punjab. So in his writing, Mund articulates what Greta Garg describes as the ideal relationship between human and nature. That is a relation that requires a kind of speaking with and listening to nature, a relation of human embeddedness in nature that is physical, psychological, spiritual, and which still preserves the distinct identities of human and nature. The novel delineates the nuances of the relationship that human beings must maintain with the surrounding natural world if they hope to survive and live in that place. However, a sort of alienation also accompanies Birsa because everything has transformed in a very fast manner around him. So he is unable to settle himself and unable to identify himself in that transformed atmosphere. Alienated from his land and environment, he mostly lives in the past and goes back to the memory lane when fascinated by the Green Revolution, the new generation that is represented by his son, for the first time associated the crops with profit making and killed the diversity of the fields through monopoly of paddy and rice. It was the time when the mechanization of agriculture started through tractors and threshers, and hybrid seeds made their claim for the first time on the land of Punjab. When Balkar, that he's the one who is representing the second generation, when he started working in the fields, he argued for changing the seeds. There was tradition of passing the seeds from one generation to the other. Birsa did not mind his son's claiming of changing the seeds, but when he said these useless seeds do not have any yield, he felt very humiliated because it was actually a challenge to the whole tradition which was going on, and suddenly there was a rupture in that tradition. From this time onwards, the crop was only associated with profit. This might look quite an ordinary event that the old seeds were replaced by the new seeds that apparently carried more yield. However, if we go into the nuances of it, we find a different story. First, seeds were never associated with the profit making. They were transferred from one generation to the other and had a genetic makeup that went back thousands of years, and the involvement of wooden plows, water wheels, and bullock carts along with the agricultural practices driven by the energy provided by animals and humans. Here, there is a repetitive image in the novel that is of the bullock carts. Because they have been replaced by the tractors, and how they have been replaced, that people have made water tanks on the roofs of their houses in the form of bullock carts. So through that the living image, which actually, you know, kind of fixed on the roofs of the houses, that tells the story of how the relationship which the humans shared with animals through a relationship with the soil, that there came a significant change in that. But the new coming back to this idea of the seeds, old and new seeds, but the new seeds have a very narrow genetic base. The earlier generation never considered the less production of seeds as immoral, but a lot more came in the baggage of new seeds. The indigenous varieties, rich in minerals and nutrients, and that consumed less water and were resistant to changing climate, were lost because of the monopoly of monoculture in the post-Green Revolution period. Second, Mund personifies the hybrid seeds and writes that these seeds had a choice of their own. The new seeds had more demands and consumed more water than the earlier varieties. These new seeds also led to the overuse of pesticides and groundwater resources, which has further caused the infertility of the land and loss of groundwater. Mund depicts this pain as a mistrust between the seeds and the fields. Birsa feels that his son was also changing along the seeds because land and water are commodities for him, whereas it was a source of life, identity, and history for his generation. The novelist points out that the most valuable treasure of the earlier generation was the experience, the direct experience that they got from through their relationship with the agriculture. Its worldview, relation with land and environment was the outproduct of experience that provided them a strong anchor to brave the difficulties posed by time. Pessimism and trends like suicide were not part of this life, whereas the next generations are bereft of this experience. They are involved in agriculture, but it never becomes a part of their inner experience. So here, the grandson who is representing the present generation, he stands for this, you know, when he's saying that he does not have any experience. Basically, he's questioning this thing that they have kind of snapped all the links with the past, and they are not learning anything from that. So this generation he's talking about, he says they are involved in agriculture, but it never becomes the part of their inner experience. Their thoughts did not come out of any experience, rather they have taken shape out of their or somebody else's imagination. These thoughts, sense, experience lead to a divided self. That is why there is a miscommunication between these three generations. I mean, the first generation is living in the past because it is totally feeling unsettled because of that transformed atmosphere. And the second generation was that happily adapted the, you know, the technologies and the changes brought in by the Green Revolution. And the third is one that is facing the consequences of that. So there is, all these three generations are interrelated with each other. Still, you know, some gap is there because they are not able to associate with each other because their worldview is totally different from each other. So these thoughts, sense, experience lead to a divided self. Whenever Birsa felt anger because of what was happening around, he always felt that he was angry with some imagination, not with some real person. So there was always absence of his son and grandson. When the grandson, he thinks about his grandfather, it was difficult to understand his grandfather because of two reasons. First, he looked at the soil as a living being. Second, he never associated the crop with profit. And when his grandfather talked about these two things collectively, it was difficult to listen to him. So there is a critic called Gurmukh Singh. He points out that this narrating a tale of tradition and past, the novel challenges the monopoly of the present, which is based on the rejection of everything belonging to past. It is a narrative of cultural memory. Here I have some reservations what this critic has pointed out, because the novels which have been written earlier also related to the agrarian structure of Punjab and including this novel also. So the kind of critical writings which you find on these works, there is a, these writings have been looked from this perspective that they have overpraised these writers, that they have honestly, you know, represented the what was the agrarian structure, what kind of problems were there, and how the present generation does not have any relationship with the past, and all these things. Now I go back to that part of my presentation when I was talking about the colonial development in Punjab, and when Punjab was developed as an agrarian sector because of developing capitalism somewhere else. That is because of the textile mills were set up in England, and so the commercial crops were grown in Punjab, and Punjab became agrarian center for Britishers. So the same thing happened post Green Revolution also, that industry was not developed in Punjab. It was kept as agrarian center only. And but yeah, so the kind of development which happened during the colonial period, it also had its ecological repercussions. But the problem is the writers, those who are writing here, not only in post 2000, but those who were writing in 90s and 80s also, they did not account for those changes which were coming because of colonial structure and because of colonial intervention in agriculture in Punjab. That is why when they talk about what were the changes coming in Punjab, so they say that there is a complete break with the past. I would say that this complete break is there is not on the part of the reader but on the part of the writer also, because they are not taking into account those changes. So that is why when he says that this novel is a narrative of cultural memory, and it represents that thing, that there is a rejection of everything past, I say that there is a strong element of nostalgia here on part of Mund also, and on part of those critical writers also, those who are writing on these novels. So Mund's insightful narrative unravels the layers of a state deeply impacted by Green Revolution, and I would again emphasize that they do not take into account the earlier changes. This swift transition also takes Mund's narrative towards the romantic images and tropes, resulting in nostalgia for the past. I have used a term here. It's a retrospective machinery used by Joseph Brodsky. So basically, it is that whether retrospective machinery here refers to the whether pleasant or dismal, the past is always a safe territory, if only because it is already experienced, and the species capacity to revert to run backward, especially in thoughts or dreams, since there we are all safe as well, is extremely strong in all of us, quite irrespective of the reality we are facing. Now, there are two things. One is that critics are pointing out that there is rejection of everything of the past, but on the part of the writers, that there is this strong element of that they are living in the past, not a rejection of the past, but that past which is a selected past, not that they are taking it collectively or in a holistic manner. So in that sense, this leads to kind of reductive and monolithic perception of the past, and they do not that actually hampers the quality of their work also. I would say that, and then this also leads to the failure to understand the present, which actually becomes which actually has to pave the way for the future. So in that sense, another development that happens along with it, that the I will include the next point also, which I'm going to discuss later on, that is the binary division between rural and urban. So when despite being urbanization and industrialization above the national average in Punjab, it came to be popularly known as land of agriculturalists. The experience and the development after the Green Revolution brought the village closer to the city. S.S. Gill summarized this as, with the penetration of capitalist relations in agriculture, modern education has spread. Most of the Punjab have schools and colleges, etc. And because of this kind of agrarian crisis, small farmers or landless people in villages have adopted other means of livelihood in cities or semi-urban areas, providing them a source of income. It has also freed them to a certain extent, I'm emphasizing, from the repression of upper class in the villages. So when Mund is talking about this, there is a strong binary between urban and rural. I mean, it's like there is a less attempt on the part of the writer to understand when the changes were coming in Punjab as a result of capitalist intensive system, and there was a new relationship being set up with the cities. And so in that sense, urban and rural cannot be understood as binary divisions, but there was this how this relationship had to be understood, and those who had moved to urban areas and looking back, how they had to see their the rural sector, that was not actually taken into account. So in that sense, what happens that the rural sector is seen as a generalized category. The populist frames tend to look at village in communitarian terms. Peasant communities that were hitherto living in peace and harmony and have been suddenly pushed into crisis by commercial capital and global markets. I again want to emphasize that after the colonial intervention in agriculture, there was this ecological erosion, and so many people approached them that they were facing the problem of water logging, salinity and all, and these kind of problems are emerging now also, but they are presented as if the peasant communities, those who have been kind of feeling alienated from their land and environment. They were living entirely in peace and harmony in the earlier times and have been suddenly pushed into crisis by commercial capital and global markets. So this kind of analysis undermines the internal differences of class and caste that are integral part of Indian agrarian scene. So at the cost of this, what happens that you associate a rural sector with some kind of idyllic imagination where everything is happening in a perfect manner. So the protagonist of the novel is not able to come to terms with this fact that agriculture and farming are no more all encompassing ways of life and identity. So this sense of nostalgia emerges from this thing also. And large proportion of there is another thing which I want to emphasize is that just bear in mind before, you know, this the first novel which I've marked out, it was written in 1993 and the second was written in 2019. So before he lived in Japan for 20 years. I mean, the first novel was published in 1993 and then he moved to Japan and he lived there for 20 years. And I would say that his experience of living in two cultures has also enriched his writing. And the ordinary events in his novels have been portrayed with this subtlety that shows the influence of living in other culture on his writings. But at the same time, I also want to say that he says in one of his interviews that for the first time, I saw my village and farming life from a distance. This distance brought me closer to the farming and the experience of farmers. What you cannot see in your society while living there starts collecting in the form of memories. So this experience of staying away from Punjab for a certain period of time has also led to a sense of nostalgia in his writings, because when you see his writing collectively, you see that, you know, there is this sense of a frozenness of time that when he left Punjab and came back to Punjab, he is looking at Punjab from the earlier perspective only when he left this. So in that sense, these two things are important here. So in this sense, in Punjabi novel, there is underlying rejection of the urban. It's very interesting that when there is discussion of the urban, so urban is basically associated with rootlessness and rural is associated with the sense of belonging and sense of community. So this needs to be looked at very critically. So another important thing in the novel is that the novel depicts the roots of alienation from land and environment also lie in the experience of 1984, which has deeply affected the psyche of Punjabis. Mand writes, "A word 84 is always looking for opportunities to come to the surface. It is difficult to tell when it starts breathing like a rumor." There has not been any attempt to understand these changes, and even less in the Punjabi novel. The novel again and again hints at that the contemporary Punjab cannot be understood without understanding the nuances of 84. In this sense, the ecological, economic, political, and cultural are closely associated. Then Mann's novels are mainly focused on Puad region of Punjab. So the aesthetic and cultural beauties and possibilities of Puad language, that is a dialect in Punjabi, appear distinctly in his novels. He is generally associated with a form of novel which is known as a regional novel. Shamil is of the view that this is injustice to his creative potential. Mand has basically preserved the culture of the region through fictional representation. P. Lal, in the preface of the novel, points out that the regionalism depicted through the in the novel through nuanced and crafted language is in harmony with the spirit of Punjab. So I end my presentation here, and in terms of conclusion, I want to say that the works of Mand depict the erosion of the environment, is also an erosion of human subjects' conscious and material access to everything that might fall under the heading of geography. And this also changes the relationship between exteriority and interiority, as I have discussed the inner landscape and outer landscape. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sumandeep, for the presentation. The forum is open for discussion. So please indicate if you want to give a feedback or if you want to ask a question. We will address each question one by one. Yes. Yeah. Professor C.K. Raju, please go ahead.
Thank you. I like your presentation, but this is very far off from my area. I mean, I like the part about how colonialism transformed Punjab before the agricultural revolution did. I was curious, you mentioned Ranjana Padi.
Yes.
What aspect of her work are you referring to? I am familiar with the person, but not with the work.
She has basically worked on that post-Green Revolution, the changes which came into Punjab, how they affected the women in Punjab. So she has actually in the Malwa region of Punjab, so there were a number of suicides. I mean, all of us know this thing. So she, in 2007, she had a field work, and on the basis of that, she has actually, you know, written a book called Those Who Did Not Die. So the, you know, because of what kind of changes that came in Punjab, and the farmers, they started committing suicides, but still behind them, there are women, you know, those who are taking care of the families and all. So in that, she has talked about what kind of influence it had on the women of Punjab. But at the same time, she also talks about this thing also, that actually, you know, when we talk about Punjab, the Jat Sikh community is very, very important. But through her analysis, we come to know that it had repercussions for this Jat Sikh community also, because they had also, those who had less land holdings, they had to sell their lands, and how, what kind of struggle their women are going through, because you belong to a Jat Sikh family, you cannot work in somebody else's fields, you cannot work the domestic work and all. So how you go through, you know, this kind of crisis. So her writing has dealt with this aspect. So I'll include it in the analysis of other novels also.
Thanks. So before we take the next question, Dr. Chahal has asked a question on chat. Congratulations, dear Sumandeep, for your second presentation. My question is slightly different from your main theme, though it is related to the issue of Green Revolution. My question is that if agricultural revolution became real, it happened largely due to the availability of water resources in Punjab. So is there any real problem of water for irrigation in Punjab, and why the issue of SYL has turned so much sensitive in the state?
I was expecting this question, and from you only, sir. And I mean, when we say that, I'll address this first part of your question, that Green Revolution became possible due to the availability of water resources in Punjab. That is one part of the whole discussion. I mean, it does not include other aspects. There were other things also. I mean, as I have pointed out in my presentation, that during the colonial period, the agrarian sector was set up, but it had serious setback after the partition. And then again, you know, it took around 20 to 25 years to set up these systems, like, you know, dams were established, and no doubt water resources were there. And so it was not only the water resources that led to the Green Revolution, there were so many other things also. And as far as this problem of the issue of SYL is concerned, that is a very, very sensitive issue. Yeah, yes, you have also mentioned it, that I think that, I mean, when this issue is understood in context of Punjab and neighboring states, particularly Haryana, so it is more understood in terms of what are the emotional overtones of this. I mean, it's like, even if we go back to 1970s and the early part of 1980s, when, you know, this there was this foundation, was SYL, this issue came to the forefront, and in this Kapuri village, Indira Gandhi came, and you know, after that whole problem started and all this thing. So actually, the issue was related to the question of decentralization and federalism, which was not addressed to, and it was given, you know, different kind of color. I mean, because of other developments which were happening in Punjab. So I do not have any kind of, you know, permanent solution which I can kind of give, but still I can just say that, you know, this issue should be addressed in terms of decentralization, not in terms of because when there was over intervention of center in terms of to whom and which state what kind of water resources have to be allocated, that created more problems. So I think that can be, you know, kind of sorted out in some sense through mutual, you know, mutual agreement between the states, you know, those who are dealing with these kind of issues. Thank you.
Yes, yes, Subbu sir, please go ahead.
Sir, your mic.
Okay, thank you. I really loved the presentation.
Thank you.
It brought back a lot of memories of Tamil literature, which I keep reading because there's a lot of parallel things that you can share. In fact, that was going to be my suggestion, that if you do have the time, looking at parallel kind of treatment in other regional literature may give you a lot of insights into your own work. I suppose every region goes through this problem of depresentization and loss of identity and how they coped with it. And literature, I mean, at least Tamil literature, I know, is extremely rich in this. Some of the best writers have written on this.
Okay.
I was quite intrigued by your statement that novel was never developed in Punjab significantly, except for these few that you mentioned. And you also somehow mentioned that poetry and theater, which were probably more developed in Punjab, did not really carry the ecological concerns. That surprises me, particularly why didn't short story ever develop as a genre for this issue? Let me just finish this thing about the novel. And even within the novel, it seems that epic format seems to be the, you know, format which is used by this nostalgic kind of frames. You know, great romantic past, declining and present, and you know, hopeless future kind of frame. So the epic format becomes, you know, several generations living together from a romantic past onwards. I see the similar parallels in Tamil literature also. You know, there is a lot of people who use the epic format to do this. But I was quite interested why, but in Tamil at the same time you have very strong ecological statements or even analysis of the crisis or the anxiety produced by ecological change or human intervention in short stories. The excellent short stories which focus, and you know, within 20 pages or so, they have really worked out the anxieties of, you know, changing. Like there is a very classic story on cutting down of a forest to convert it into a factory site. And it's not actually a forest, but it's a clump of trees, tamarind trees. But the anxiety that it involves is so deeply brought out in a very short story. And I was just interested how, which genres are used for the ecological concerns. One other thing which I find very prominent in the Tamil literature on ecological change is a very detailed focus on transformation of the labor process. Now, actually, the work people do, the pain it causes, the stress on the body, on the family, whether it is planting or harvesting or tending cattle or whatever. In your discussion today, it didn't come out. The transformation of labor process from what it was earlier and what it is now becoming. And who are the people doing the process? This also is somewhat missing in this description. Particularly if, as you say, capitalism has taken over and replaced peasant production, it would mean that the actual labor process are being done by someone else, not the peasants. Probably Bihari laborers or I don't know what, Madhya Pradeshi laborers or Chhattisgarhia laborers. Even children from Rajasthan who come here to do your cotton picking.
Yes.
So what happens to the labor process and who is doing the labor process? I don't know whether your novels take up these issues. I mean, this was some of the issue. Other thing was, you mentioned this person going to Japan. Was he in touch with Fukuoka?
Can you repeat, sir?
Fukuoka, the Japanese environmentalist farmer, whose famous book on One Straw Revolution is actually a classic on organic farming. I was just wondering whether there was any influence of his on this writer.
Okay,
thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you for suggesting that the parallel kind of treatment can be seen in my writings. And I'll see if I can include that considering the time and all. So, second thing which the question which you have raised regarding the which I pointed out that there was less development of novel and like these other genres like theater and all. I am not saying that these other genres like poetry and short stories, they did not address these issues, but they are more in fragmentary form. So that is part of my review of literature, which I have included in the introduction. So, and I have pointed out that what kind of literature was being written in other genres like short stories and all. But why I did not make them the significant part because of the holistic picture that novel is giving. And this question that there is this less development of novel and all, it was from this perspective that when we see the development of novel from the beginning to the end, there is less experiment on the part of writers to develop this form and this genre. That is why I am saying that, it's like, I'll give you example of this novelist only, which I have analyzed in my presentation. Is he himself also points out that he says that though the novel in Punjabi is 100 years old, it is still in its infancy because of this, lack of engagement with the new forms and lack of experimentation and all. So this was the point which I was trying to emphasize. Then the another thing which you pointed out, that is why I have not focused on transformation of labor force. This is not part of these writings, like Jasbir Mand does not address this issue in his novels. These are part of my, next novels, which I think it will be part of my next chapter. So that is why I did not include it in this presentation, because this novelist does not address these issues. This was the reason. Thank you.
So I request Professor Madhav Hada to...
सुमन जी बहुत बहुत बधाई आपको. मेरी एक छोटी सी जिज्ञासा है. साहित्य एक स्वायत्त अनुशासन है. दो आयाम है आपके इस प्रेजेंटेशन की, एक पर्यावरण की समस्या और दूसरा उपन्यास। आप पर्यावरण की समस्या से उपन्यास में जा रही हैं या उपन्यास में पर्यावरण की समस्या से पर्यावरण की समस्या को समझ रही हैं?
सर, मुझे लगता है ये दोनों अलग अलग नहीं है। आई मीन दे आर क्लोजली इंटेग्रेटेड विद ईच अदर, क्योंकि जब मैं नॉवल की बात कर रही हूँ, पंजाबी नॉवल की बात कर रही हूँ, तो उस दैट इज बीइंग रिटन इन अ पर्टिकुलर कॉन्टेक्स्ट, और वो जो कॉन्टेक्स्ट है वो उस जिसमें आप बात कर रहे हैं कि पर्यावरण वाला जो है, वो कॉन्टेक्स्ट उससे इमर्ज हो रहा है। सो इन दैट सेंस मुझे लगता है कि मैं इसमें एक ये हायरार्की नहीं बना सकती कि पहले इसकी बात करी हूँ फिर इसकी बात करी हूँ या इससे इसमें मूव करी हूँ, ये दोनों पैरेलल चलते हैं। तो उसी में से जो एक थ्योरेटिकल फ्रेमवर्क डेवलप होता है कि व्हाट काइंड ऑफ राइटिंग्स आर बीइंग रिटन एंड व्हाट काइंड ऑफ कॉन्टेक्स्ट इज अवेलेबल, एंड सो आई थिंक इन दोनों में एक पैरेलल काइंड ऑफ डेवलपमेंट है। थैंक यू।
थैंक यू।
Perhaps you have not followed the question of Professor Madhav Hara, and I believe that you need to engage with this subject more deeply in the light of what Professor Madhav Hara had said. And I'm saying this because engaging with literature, literary novel as a text, and to relate it to ecological questions, or for that matter, any question, you need to engage it in a very deeply, I mean, it's a very complicated affair. When I was listening, I found that you are making some kind of confusion and some kind of ambiguity is also emerging in your presentation. You are talking about the Industrial Revolution context, and that is one break. I mean, this in Indian context, in 19th century break, then you are bringing a Green Revolution break. And you are also coming up with some kind of generalizations in which you are talking about this glorification of the past or nostalgic take of the past. These are very complicated questions. And as a literature student, you need to have something in a way which can actually give us something to think about it differently. I'll give an example. Subramaniam ji brought Bihari laborers into it, and I'm bringing a Bihari writer into this whole discourse. And that is Farnishunath Renu. And I had mentioned, I remember, in your introductory presentation, Farnishunath Renu has written a remarkable book, Parthi Parikatha. And in that context, these all questions you have raised today have come in a very prominent manner. In fact, if you bring those things into a kind of comparative understanding, then your presentation would be, or your work would be, better, in if I may say so. Because you see, these writings need an engagement of the present, of the present context. And if you are ready to come up with an idea that a globalization period brought a new kind of perspective, you have talked about three generations and three generations, a different kind of engagement. You have also questioned the binary of urban and rural. And these questions are actually seen very differently in post-1990 novels. You can argue that, and that's a very fair argument. And people like Renu, who wrote in 50s and 60s, they had another kind of take on this whole subject of effects on peasants' life and coming of technology and all that. And earlier generations, for example, I'm not familiar with Punjabi literature that way, but I can think of Premchand's age, where past came very differently. So these are the three kind of frames which actually can come into the play in your kind of work. So I found a bit of ambiguity and some kind of, I would not like to use that, but a kind of shallowness also comes into the play. As a serious researcher, you have to go deeper into it. And you have to pick the frame more carefully. Because if you're really bringing in a 90s, post-90s perspective and globalization and all that, then you may have a point. You may have something new to add to this knowledge that these novelists have been bringing something very new to it. And in that connection, the context of literature or novels narrative could be saying something deeper, which may not be available in newspaper reports. Something which can connect to the past, connect to the present memory and all that. Or if you want to go in a historical way, bringing colonial context also into it, post-colonial context and globalization context in that way. So these are three different things. And I found a kind of confusion. I may be wrong and it may be my own problem, but that problem persists. So I think you need to if I may say so, you have to be a little bit careful about it, because there are some observations which need more convincing backing. I mean, exposition of those things. So I would repeat this time again that you must somehow get a copy of Parthi Parikatha and read that, and then you will be able to understand. I wanted to.
Thank you, sir. I'll take care of
this. Add a comment to what Professor Hada and Patel had said briefly. See, I'm quite interested in how the form of novel as a genre gets changed by introduction of an environmental concern. Does that happen first? So does the novel as a form itself change? Is there a transformation of the novel that happens? That is one. I'll give you an example, which is a very different one. If you look at the, say, Shivaram Karan's novels, there's a very strange thing. You know, for me as a reader in 20th century or the 21st century, his characters, he romanticizes the present and the future generation. The younger generation is always romanticized as the harbingers of change. And the old generation is always treated as something, decadent. Now, when I find that the end of 20th century, this is the freedom movement time. Today, at the end of the 20th century, 50 years or 70 years after freedom, we find a reverse. We romanticize the past generation and denigrate the present generation. This reversal within the novel form intrigues me a lot.
सुमन जी, मैं आप सुब्रमण्यम सर का प्रश्न क्या उत्तर दें उससे पहले मैं एक बात और पूछना चाहता हूँ। थोड़ी देर के लिए ये सोचिए, आपकी एक उपन्यासकार को यदि पर्यावरण समस्या पर ही विचार करना होता तो वो पर्यावरण समस्या पर एक किताब लिखता। उसे उपन्यास के अनुशासन में जाने की जरूरत क्यों हुई? ये बहुत, इसको यूं समझिए कि वो फिर एक लेख लिखता अखबार में, एक मान लीजिए कोई कविता का अनुशासन लेता है तो प्रयोजन पूर्वक है, उपन्यास के अनुशासन में जाता है तो प्रयोजन पूर्वक है। किसी उपन्यासकार का अनुशासन पर्यावरण नहीं है, फिर भी वो पर्यावरण में जा रहा है, तो इस बात पर विचार बहुत जरूरी है कि वो अपने अनुशासन का उपयोग पर्यावरण की समस्या के लिए क्यों कर रहा है, तब तो इसका कोई महत्व बनता है।
या सर, आई विल एड्रेस दीज क्वेश्चंस what you have pointed out and what Subbu sir has also pointed out. That also I think I'll think more about it and then develop this point that how, I mean, the form of the novel gets changed because of these ecological issues and all. Thank you for your suggestions, and I'll think about these more and I'll incorporate these things into my project.
Do we have any questions? Okay.
I have one question.
Please, sir, go ahead.
Small question. I was just wondering, there was a very rich tradition in pre-partition Punjab. See, Lahore was such a big center. Is that not part of Punjab? But there is no mention at all of what happened. We even had a fellow here, Bhishma Sahani, long time back. So there were many such figures at that point of time. Why has that got completely eclipsed? Was there no ecological concern at that time?
No. Sir, there is ecological concern in that also, but as I pointed out in my last presentation, that I'll be focusing on this part of Punjab. That is why I didn't refer to it in this presentation.
So Professor Purohit has a question. Please go ahead, sir.
I had already sent a question through my chat. Probably you didn't see it. There's a mass tenancy in Punjab, as I know, of shifting to Mexico. They are buying land in Mexico at a large scale. All Punjabi Sikhs, particularly the rural, the agrarian population, is shifting to Mexico, and others are already thinking of going to Canada, US, and Germany.
Mm-hmm.
Does this matter also reflect in Mount's novels? And the second thing, I also agree with Professor Hada, that you have chosen a form, or Mount has chosen a form that is a literary novel. And in that novel, there are more of thingness in the novels. And my first question, this mass tendency of going away from Punjab, maybe this colonies being constructed everywhere in Punjab and the land being sold to the, everybody is thinking to move away from rural Punjab.
I mean, the earlier question which you have asked, whether there
just an observation, I think what Professor Hada has said, that is a very vital question and very vital issue and point which must be paid attention to.
Yeah.
This is a second.
Yes, I will. I'll pay attention to it. Yeah, please, I will.
Yes. And the second question is this tendency of going away from Punjab. What are the causes, and is this phenomenon reflected in the novels of Mount?
Yeah, sir, this tendency of moving away from Punjab, this migration, that is not part of Mount's novels. I mean, there is still a desire in the characters that they want to move, but they are living in that kind of dilemma whether they should go or go, they should not go. But when you move to the next novels, then this desire comes in a very open manner and it gets reflected in the other writings. So, I mean, okay. I wanted to include this also in my presentation, but since it is not part of Mann's writings, so I did not include it in this one.
That's fine. My question is answered.
I think Dr. Venusa had a question. Dr. Venusa, you can go ahead. Dr. Venusa, I think he's. Thank you.
Okay, I'll come to you, Dr. Venuja, and we can discuss if you do not have mic and cannot speak. So I can discuss with you whatever your question is.
Yes. Any more questions or you have any more? Yes, yes, Professor Patel, please go ahead. Yeah.
As because Professor Hara has raised a question, and Professor Purohit also expressed some concern over there. I think Sumandeep is perfectly all right in taking literature to say something related to ecology. And it is not perhaps fair to say that if you have to say something about history, you write history and not novel. It is quite possible that a literature can bring in history in a way which is more comprehensive, perhaps more deeper than a historian can. This is obviously something on which anybody who has read Kurutula and Hadar and many great novelists can agree to. So that is a fair thing for Sumandeep, that literature can be source of alternative way of looking at something about which some specialized knowledge is also available. What I wanted to raise, and perhaps Sumandeep would find it useful, is that when you deal with a novel as a site of something which has been said by some other specialist in a different way,
mm-hmm.
I expect, or we expect, something different, and that difference lies in the approach and the way a novelist can think about an old man and his son and his grandson's perspectives into a play where you can pick one or two things which may not be available in newspaper writing, where past comes to us in a very, very different way and in a much deeper way. You have referred to the past. Which past? Whose past? And here literary man can give us something very different. And that kind of play is possible in literature. For that, I think the reading of literature can be quite useful. Mm-hmm. And perhaps it gives us a better perspective of reality. That is how I look at it. So bringing literature is a welcome move, and I think for that Sumandeep should get my support. And I think literature is an interesting site. And anything and everything can be brought into the can add to our knowledge. So bringing ecological questions from these kind of sources is a very welcome thing, and that should be appreciated and that should be encouraged. In fact, I wanted to bring in this because the old idea that history is a historian's concern and ecology is ecological science people's concern is not acceptable to me. So I support Sumandeep's project on that point.
Thank you.
Okay, so
I have a question.
Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah. Any question? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes.
I don't have a question, but I was, while listening to your presentation, I'm reminded of a past literature, many novels that have come up during on this condition of England, poverty during industrialization period. And there is a vast literature on that. While reading on the evolution of concept of poverty, there are two sources. One is the historian's writing on evolution of concept of poverty and the literature. There are many novels. So, in fact, there is one very good article that industrialization and poverty in fact and fiction. So, something like what you are trying to do has been done earlier. So far as this issues of poverty are concerned during industrialization period. So if you can look at this one article, you will get the idea.
Okay, thank you.
In the book, one of the great novels was Ragged Trousered Philanthropist by Robert Tressel. You know, it's on the right on the poverty issue arising out of industrial revolution.
You know, Dickens' novel is there. There are many novels.
Yes,
and
yes.
This, this historian, Heberflack, she has written on how the concept of poverty evolved. And then she has drawn from these novels. So you can look at this literature. That will help you.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
She's not looking at poverty, is she? Looking not like Charles Dickens looking at the time of the Industrial Revolution. Your focus seems to be quite different about what happened after the agricultural revolution, and not even what happened in colonial times and so on, what happened after the agricultural revolution, which is completely a different context from, let's say, Charles Dickens writing about the Industrial Revolution.
No, but the use of the form of novel.
Form.
That is the
point.
No, no, sir.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, both these, even if we talk about the ecological changes in Punjab in context of Green Revolution and all, both these have been addressed in literature also and in historical and other writings also. So that is why I pointed out in some part of my presentation that along with the literary theorist, I'll be drawing on the works of these writers like Ranjana Padhi and all. So that, you know, it's like that can help me in developing the context in a more significant way. So I think, yeah, ma'am was more talking about that form. So thank you, ma'am, for suggestion.
Okay, so I think thank you so much. Thank you so much for the presentation, Dr. Mandi. I think we'll call it a day. And it's always such, there's so much learning that happens when these discussions and these presentations go. And okay, Professor Patel wants to say something. Please go ahead.
What I want to add is that this webinar thing is proving a hindrance for us. I remember that whenever there was any discussion, when we used to meet in reality, what happened? And never ever the discussion could end before 5 o'clock. But nowadays people are so reluctant to speak, and I think that this is something which is, this is not good. We need to come out with critical suggestions. And what is wrong in coming up with critical comments? And because she is completing just 1 year, I mean, she still has one more year. So let us be more critical, bringing some new things and discuss among ourselves. And what is wrong with that? I mean, we have a tradition of arguing sometimes little more critically. So that is why I think that this is a poor reflection on our webinars, that it is closing much before 5 o'clock. I think
Mr. Patel keh rahe hain, toh main jari rakhta hoon isko.
Only 10 minutes. Only 10 minutes. We are not more.
Suman ji, jis upanyas ka zikr Professor Patel kar rahe hain, main प्रति परिकथा, मुझे लगता है मैं उस उपन्यास को यदि मुझे अभी भी दिया जाए तो मैं फिर पढ़ सकता हूँ, और मैंने कितनी बार उसको पढ़ लिया। उसमें भारत एक सेटलमेंट, आजादी के बाद सेटलमेंट की प्रक्रिया शुरू हुई रेवेन्यू में, और रेवेन्यू की सेटलमेंट की उस प्रक्रिया ने भारतीय जनसाधारण को इतना विचलित किया, किसकी जमीन होगी नहीं होगी, किसका दावा होगा नहीं होगा, ये सब उस उपन्यास में है। लेकिन खास बात यह है कि वो कोई समाजशास्त्रीय दृष्टिकोण नहीं है। एक बात जो नोट करने की है, मैं आपसे आरंभ में जो पूछ रहा था ना कि आप उपन्यास से समस्या पर जा रही है, समस्या से उपन्यास पर आ रही है, रेणु एक उपन्यास की तरह से उस समस्या को नरेट करते हैं, लेकिन वो एक उपन्यासकार की समस्या है, उसके माध्यम उसका अपना माध्यम है, वो कोई समाजशास्त्र का माध्यम नहीं है, वो पर्यावरण विज्ञान का माध्यम नहीं है, वो उपन्यास का उसकी अपनी विद्या, उसका अपना अनुशासन। ये देखा जाना चाहिए किसी उपन्यास में कि क्या वो अपने माध्यम में चीजों को ढाल रहा है या आत्मसात कर रहा है या नहीं कर रहा, या केवल एक समाजशास्त्रीय समस्या को, एक पर्यावरण पर्यावरणीय समस्या को एज इट इज रख रहा है पात्रों के माध्यम से। आप उपन्यास पढ़ते हुए कहीं नहीं लगेगा कि वो कोई समाजशास्त्रीय अध्ययन है, कुछ नहीं है, लेकिन मुझे लगता है कि किसी समाजशास्त्रीय अध्ययन से वो बेहतर अध्ययन, बेहतर अनुशासन।
ओके okay. Sumandeep, it was a very comprehensive presentation and smoothly done. But this question that began with the Professor Hara's comment on the novel as a literary text, talking about a cultural or scientific issue on one hand, and factual documents that document or report the issues of a community. I would rather like to support you on this, that the new historicist perspective, which evolved in the literary theories, has already been propagating or establishing the literary text as one of the most important cultural documents, like which Hitendra sir also pointed out, that you know, he supports that you take the literary text as a, because it allows us to go deeper into human problems, not only because it brings in the emotional aspect of, you know, the feeling, the pain, the pleasure, the holistic impact of the whole environment, whole living reality. A literary document captures the living reality in a more holistic manner, and I'm in a way just making an observation that I agree that with Hitendra sir, that you must be congratulated on this aspect, that you are trying to look at a literary text and how the literary text is bringing out the ecological concerns in Punjab. Saying that much, I would also agree that maybe, you know, you can look into more and more frameworks which are available, because you will perhaps be enriching your own expression if you look into, say, for instance, Professor Medhaji was talking about an article, like, you know, just the formula. Maybe the formula yes. will be enriched if you are looking into these parallel expressions. For instance, Subramaniam sir also pointed out about this short story, for instance. It could be this short story in 20 pages is expressing that same thing in the living reality of, say, Tamil Nadu. So maybe these formulaic expression can help you to further enrich your own writing or your own research, I feel. Thank you so much. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Just let me add one point, since we are talking so much about this, fiction versus history. We had a fellow here, one Dhar Saab, T.N. Dhar, Tejnath Dhar, who wrote on history-fiction interface. So, you know, you really don't know where history begins and where fiction ends. And he was talking about all these authors, Tharoor and so on, three, four of these modern authors. So he was a fellow in Shimla a long time back. And I presume his book would be there in the library.
Okay, so
there really isn't so much of a difference between history and fiction.
Yeah.
Okay, I think. Okay, so finally, thank you so much, and I think we'll end the presentation here. All right.
Thank you for chairing the session.
Sure. Okay.
Thank you, everyone. Yeah. Thank you so much.